prison has increased 646%. 70% of the women we send to jails and prisons are single parents with minor children, which means that when they go to jails and prisons, their children get displaced. And we haven't really confronted it. We do terrible things to people when they come out of jails and prisons. In 2015, President Obama came to my state of Alabama to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the march in Selma to Montgomery, which led to the Voting Rights Act. 80,000 people came, members of Congress came, they marched across the bridge, but very few of them realized that today in the state of Alabama, 30% of the black male population has permanently lost the right to vote as a result of a criminal conviction. The statistic that worries me the most is the one from the Bureau of Justice. The Bureau of Justice now predicts that 1 in 3 black male babies born in this country is expected to go to jail or prison during his lifetime. 1 in 3. That was not true in the 20th century. It wasn't true in the 19th century. It has become true in the 21st century. The statistic for Latino boys is 1 in 6. I could talk about these problems all afternoon. I could talk about the problems that we're facing when it comes to climate change, when it comes to poverty, when it comes to helping people who are disabled, when it comes to dealing with these complex issues of security and peace. But I want to talk to you about solutions, because to change the world, I am persuaded, there are 4 things we have to do. The first is we've got to be willing, notwithstanding our law degree from the Washington College of Law, we've got to be willing to get proximate to people who are poor, who are suffering, who are excluded, who are disfavored. We cannot change the world if we allow our law degrees to put us in spaces where we're disconnected from those who suffer from inequality. If we allow it to isolate ourselves from the challenges that we see in our society, we will not create more justice. We can only create justice when we get closer to those who are suffering. Many of you have been taught your whole lives that if there's a part of town where there's a lot of violence or abuse or neglect or despair, many of you have been taught to stay as far away from that part of town as possible. Today, I'm going to argue the opposite. I'm going to urge you to get closer to the parts of your community where there's despair and marginalization, where there's poverty and suffering. And I urge you to get closer to the incarcerated and the condemned, because I am persuaded that when you get proximate, you will find the power that this degree gives you. There is power in proximity. You don't have to have all the answers when you choose to get proximate, but when you are there, you'll see things and you'll do things that you cannot do from a distance. You've got these politicians ordering solutions, and their solutions don't work because they're so far away from the problems, they can't see the nuances and the details. There is power in proximity. Of our family, and she was tough, and she was strong, and she was the end of every argument in our family. She was also the start of a lot of arguments. And when I was a little boy, my grandmother would see me, and she'd come up to me, and she'd give me these hugs, where she squeezed me so tightly I could barely breathe. I thought she was trying to hurt me. And then an hour later, she'd see me, she'd say, "Bryan, do you still feel me hugging you?" And if I said no, she would jump on me again. And if I said yes, she would let me be. And by the time I was 10, my grandmother had taught me, whenever I would see her, the first thing they would say is, "Mama, I always feel you loving me." And she would smile this smile. And I didn't understand what she was doing until she was older. In her 90s, she worked as a domestic her whole life, and one day she fell. And she broke her hip, and she developed cancer, and she was on her deathbed, and I was so grieved and so sad. And I went to spend time with my grandmother, and I was holding her hand, saying my final words. I didn't even think she was awake. And I stood up to leave, and my grandmother squeezed me by the hand. And the last thing she said to me, she said, "Bryan, are you still feeling me hugging you?" And then she said, "I'm always going to be hugging you. And I know that many of you would not be sitting here if people who didn't love you, if people who didn't care about you, hadn't embraced you and told you and persuaded you that you could be in this space. And what they've given you, I want you to give to other people." And they don't have to be the same. There are no high schools for black teenagers. And my dad was was that of that age. You couldn't go to high school. And then these lawyers came into our community. They made them comply with Brown versus Board of Education because those lawyers chose to get proximate. I got to go to high school. I graduated from high school. I got to go to college. I was a philosophy major in college. I didn't really know what I was going to do. And when I was a senior, I went on the hillside because I thought I was a philosophy major. I was supposed to be thinking deep thoughts. I got to the hillside one day, and somebody came up to me and said, "You're a senior, and you're a philosophy major. What are you going to do when you graduate from college?" I heard this as a very hostile question. And I remember trying to figure out how to stay in school, because nobody in my family had gone to school before. I didn't know that in this country, if you wanted to do graduate work in history or English or political science, to get admitted to graduate school in history or English or political science, you actually have to know something about history. So I kept looking, and to be honest, that's how I found my way to law school. It was very clear to me, you don't need to know anything to go to law school. But you need to know a lot to graduate, and you have achieved something by being here, and I want you to take that achievement, and I want you to go into the places where there is suffering and inequality, and people feel burdened and feel mistreated, and I want you to just get proximate. And if you get proximate, we can begin to create more justice. But that won't be enough. The second thing we have to do is that we have to change some of these narratives that sustain inequality and injustice. We have these problems in our country, we have these problems across the world, and the problems are the function of policy choices, but the policies are sustained by narratives. And we've got to change the narrative. We have mass incarceration in America because we decided to deal with drug addiction and drug dependency as a crime issue. We could have said that drug addiction and drug dependency is a health issue, but we didn't do that. We said, no, drug addicts and people drug dependent, they're criminals. Now, with alcoholism, we said, well, that's a health issue. Alcoholism is a disease, but drug dependency and drug addiction, no, that's a crime. And if we know somebody who's an alcoholic and we see them going to a bar, we would never think let's call the police, but because we didn't do that for drug addiction, we've now put hundreds of thousands of people in jails and prisons. But the reason we did that has to do with the narrative that created that policy. And I believe the narrative that created that policy is what I call the politics of fear and anger. We have politicians teaching fear. See, I really have to talk about the fact that we are living in a post-genocide society. Before white settlers came to this continent, there were millions of native people here, and we killed them by the millions through famine and war and disease. We didn't call it a genocide because we said, no, those people are savages. And we used this racial difference narrative to justify that mistreatment. We kept their names. I come to D.C. and I see the Potomac, I see the Susquehanna, I see all of these names, but we made the people leave, and that narrative of racial difference was wrong, and we've got to change it. It's that same narrative that sustained centuries of slavery. And I don't think the great evil of American slavery was involuntary servitude and forced labor. I believe the great evil of American slavery was the narrative of racial difference that we created about black people. We said black people are different than white people. They can't do this, they can't do that. They're only three-fifths human. This ideology of white supremacy, that was the true evil of American slavery. If you read the 13th Amendment, this ideology of white supremacy, it doesn't talk about this narrative of racial difference, and because of that, I don't think slavery ended in 1865. I think it just evolved. It turned into decades of terrorism and violence. They were killed in that era of terror. We didn't deal with it. And all the people of color come up to me sometimes and say, Mr. Stevenson, I get angry when I hear somebody on TV talking about how we're dealing with domestic terrorism for the first time in our nation's history after 9/11. They said, we grew up with terrorism. We had to worry about being bombed and lynched and menaced every day of our lives, and the demographic geography of this nation was shaped by this racial terror. You see the black people in Cleveland and Chicago and Detroit and Los Angeles and Oakland and Minneapolis and Boston did not go to those communities as immigrants looking for new economic opportunities. They went to those communities as refugees and exiles from terror in the American South. And that narrative continues. You know, you can do great things in the 50s and 60s to confront this legacy of segregation. I worry that we still didn't change the narrative. We've gotten too celebratory about the civil rights movement. I worry sometimes about that. And I think we've got to still deal with this legacy because we did some terrible things. We told black people, you can't go to school because you're black. We said, you can't vote because you're black. My parents were humiliated every day of their lives. They'd see those signs that say white and colored. They weren't directions. They were assaults, and they created injuries. And we haven't treated those injuries. And now this narrative of racial difference still persists. And it breaks my heart to look at this beautiful class of graduates and have to say to the students of color sitting here, even though you got this degree from the Washington College of Law, you will go places in this country where you're going to be presumed dangerous and guilty just because of your color. And that means we've got to change the narrative. I was at a courtroom not too long ago, and despite all of these arguments I've made and all of this practice I've done, I was sitting at defense counsel's table in my suit and tie, ready to start a hearing in the Midwest. And the judge walked in and he saw me sitting there and he said, hey, you get back out there in the hallway and you wait till your lawyer gets here. I don't want any defendants sitting in my courtroom without their lawyer. And I stood up and I said, well, I'm sorry, Your Honor, I didn't introduce myself. My name is Bryan Stevenson, I am the lawyer. And the judge started laughing. And the prosecutor started laughing, and I made myself laugh because I didn't want to disadvantage my client. My client came, the young white kid I was representing. And we did this hearing, but after I was thinking, what is it when this judge saw a middle-aged black man in a suit and tie? He didn't even think that that could be the lawyer. What that is this narrative of racial difference, this presumption of dangerousness and guilt. We've got to change this narrative. You go to Rwanda, they will make you hear the story of the genocide. In Germany today, in Berlin, you can't go 100 meters without seeing markers and stones that have been placed next to the homes of Jewish families that were abducted during the Holocaust. The Germans want you to go to the Holocaust Memorial and reflect soberly. They're trying to change the narrative, but in this country, we don't talk about slavery. We don't talk about lynching. We don't talk about segregation. We start talking about race, and people get nervous. You start talking about racial justice, and people are looking for exits. And I need you to be people who are willing to change this narrative, because without it, we cannot create more justice. But that won't be enough by itself either. The third thing I'm going to ask you to do, I'm going to ask you to stay hopeful. Don't lose your hope. Your hope is your power. You see, I understood that hopelessness is the enemy of justice. And when you become hopeless, you sort of become part of the problem. You see, you're either hopeful or you're the problem. Injustice prevails or hopelessness persists. So you've got to find a way to protect yourself from the things that will make you hopeless. And they will come. You're going to learn that the judges don't always respond fairly. You're going to learn that some lawyers are cynical and they don't believe that they can do anything. You're going to sometimes be surrounded by people who don't believe that the work you want to do is worth doing, and you've got to find a way to protect your hope. And your hope is what's going to get some of you to stand up when other people say sit down. Some of you are going to speak when other people say be quiet, and it's your hope that will get you up. You've got to find a way to protect your hopefulness. I tell this story a lot. When I moved to Montgomery, I had the great privilege of meeting Rosa Parks. Johnny Carr, the architect of the Montgomery bus boycott, called me up when I moved to town. She said, Brian, do you know I'm the architect of the Montgomery bus boycott? I said, yes, ma'am, I didn't know that. She said, well, I heard you're a young lawyer, just moved to town. I said, yes, I am. She said, well, if you're a young lawyer, just moved to town, sometimes I'm going to call you up and I'm going to ask you to go some places and speak. And then she said, sometimes I'm going to call you up and ask you to go some places and listen. And she said, when I call you up and ask you to do something, you're going to say, yes, ma'am. So I said, yes, ma'am. And she would call me up and send me places to speak and listen. And then one day she called me up, she said, Bryan, Rosa Parks is coming to town. We're going to get together at Virginia Durr's house. Virginia Durr is a white woman who's helping Clifford Durr, representing Dr. King. She said, do you want to come over and listen? I said, oh, yes, I do, Miss Carr. And I went over and I listened to Rosa Parks and Johnny Carr and Virginia Durr talk for 2 hours. And they didn't talk about the things they had done. They kept talking about the things they were going to do. Their hopefulness was tangible. And I soaked it all in, and it was so inspiring. And after a couple of hours, Miss Parks turned to me. She said, now, Bryan, tell me about the Equal Justice Initiative. Tell me what you're trying to do. I looked at Ms. Carr and said, I had permission to speak, and she nodded. I gave Ms. Carr my whole rap. I said, we're trying to do something about the death penalty. We're trying to do something about mass incarceration. We're trying to do something about racial bias. We're trying to do something to help the poor. We're trying to do something to help the disabled. We're trying to do something to help children prosecuted as adults. We want to deal with conditions of confinement. I gave her my whole rap, and when I finished, she looked at me, and she said, She said, that's going to make you tired, tired, tired. That's when Ms. Carr went forward, and she said, she said, that's why you've got to be brave, brave, brave. I'm going to tell you, it takes courage to stay hopeful. Because there's so much hopelessness around it. If you're brave and you're hopeful and you get proxies and you change narratives, we can begin to create more justice in the fourth and final thing. And this is the hard one. To create more justice, you're going to have to be willing to do uncomfortable things. And I hate saying that. Because biologically and psychologically, we are actually driven to do what's comfortable. And that means you actually have to make choices to do the uncomfortable things, and it's hard. And I wish it wasn't like this. I've actually done some research. I've looked for some examples where injustice was overcome, where oppression was ended, where equality triumphed, and nobody had to do anything inconvenient or uncomfortable. I can't find any examples of that. It only happens when good people, when lawyers, are willing to do the uncomfortable. And don't get me wrong, I'm not against comfort. That's not what I'm saying. I gave a talk down in Mississippi. The people met me at the airport. They said, oh, Mr. Stevenson, we know all about you. We know what kind of lawyer you are. We know what kind of work you do. We read your book. And we have to tell you that we're having our conference at the luxurious DoubleTree Hotel. And we decided that you wouldn't want to stay at the luxurious DoubleTree Hotel. You asked one of the farmers to put you up in the barn. So of course I want to stay at the luxurious DoubleTree Hotel. Like those chocolate chip cookies just like everybody else. But what I'm talking about is sometimes you've got to position yourself in uncomfortable places and you've got to be a witness. I was giving a talk in a church and an older black man came into the church. He was sitting in a wheelchair. And he was looking at me sternly, almost angrily the whole time I was talking. I couldn't figure out why he was looking at me like that. And then I got through my talk, but he kept sitting in the back staring at me. And people came up, they were very nice and friendly, but that older man was sitting in the back just staring. And finally, when everybody else was done, he got a young person to wheel him to the front of the church, and that older man came down the center aisle of that church in his wheelchair, staring at me sternly and angrily. And when he got in front of me, he put his hand up. He said, do you know what you're doing? And I just stood there. And then he asked me again, he said, do you know what you're doing? And I stepped back and I mumbled something. I don't even remember what I said. And then he asked me one last time, he said, do you know what you're doing? And then that man looked at me and he said, I'm going to tell you what you're doing. And that man looked at me and he said, you're beating the drum for justice. You keep beating the drum for justice. And I was so moved. I was also really relieved because I just didn't know. And then this man grabbed me by my jacket and he pulled me into his wheelchair. He said, come here, I'm going to show you something. And I watched this man turn his head. He said, you see this scar I have behind my right ear? He said, I got that scar on Green County, Alabama in 1963, trying to register people to vote. He turned and said, you see this cut I have down here at the bottom of my neck? Got that cut in Philadelphia, Mississippi, 1964, trying to register people to vote. He turned and said, you see this dark spot? He said, that's my bruise. Got my bruise in Birmingham, Alabama, 1965, trying to register people to vote. He said, I'm going to tell you something, young man. He said, people look at me and think I'm some old man sitting in a wheelchair covered with cuts and bruises and scars. He said, but these are not my cuts. They're not my bruises. They're not my scars. He said, these are my medals of honor. Yeah. And it's a beautiful community of young lawyers like you. Commit yourself to getting proximate if you change these narratives, if you stay hopeful, if you do these uncomfortable things, I cannot promise you that there won't be cuts and nicks and bruises and scars, but I can tell you, you will honor what it means to be that lawyer who is about justice. I believe really simple things. I believe that each of us is more than the worst thing we've ever done. That's why I do the work I do. I stand next to condemned people. I stand next to children who've been convicted of terrible crimes because I am persuaded that if someone tells a lie, they're not just a liar. If someone even kills someone, they're not just a killer. And justice requires that we know the other things they are. I am persuaded that in this country, the opposite of poverty is not wealth. I think we talk too much about money in America. I am persuaded that the opposite of poverty isn't wealth. I believe the opposite of poverty is justice. And when we do justice, we deconstruct the conditions that give rise to poverty. And finally, I believe that many of you are going to have the opportunity to do all kinds of extraordinary things. All of you will have the opportunity to represent something hopeful and just. But I want to tell you that your commitment and your capacity to change the world, don't ever think that that commitment and capacity is measured by the grades you get. I don't want you to ever think your grades are a measure of your capacity to change the world. I want you to all get good jobs, but don't ever think that your income is a measure of your capacity to change the world. Your capacity to change the world is recognized in your willingness to understand that the character of justice, the quality of justice that we seek, the commitment to the rule of law can't be evidenced by how we treat the rich and the powerful and the privileged. It's got to be evident in the way we treat the poor, the incarcerated, and the condemned. And because of that, I am excited to see a community of people like you coming from an incredible institution like this, knowing that many of you will find ways to get toxic, you'll change these narratives, you'll stay hopeful, and you'll do uncomfortable things. I am so honored to be in this space with you. I'm so honored to be a part of this event, but mostly I'm excited because I know you can create more justice, and I want you to know I'll be rooting for you, cheering you on, proud to say I was there when you started. I wish you all the very best.